while I know there are startups who have raised billions of dollars to do 10-minute delivery, my question is, how is it going to change the world if you are able to deliver something to me from 10 minutes to 20 minutes? These tools are so powerful that government should actually regulate it. Like what? Kaun regulation? Bolta hai, boss, regulate karna padega, because basically these tools have the same effect like drugs. But the only difference is drugs are illegal and can't be sourced. But right now, billion and trillion dollar companies are targeting, you know, AIs, which are billions of dollars on people's behavior. So I think this whole aspect of I'm going to be India may best, or I'm going to be good in this, does not work, because your consumer is comparing you to the best in the world. The problem is people have average or below average skills, and they are expecting to work with companies which are having plans to change the world.
In today's episode, we have a marketing genius, an entrepreneur who was the first person to build the game for Spider-Man in the world. And he's also built a game for Pepsi where users were allowed to shoot Coke cans. After doing all of these things, he has built multiple games and then sold his company to Walt Disney at $100 million. But he was not enjoying all of this, so left his managing director job and became an angel investor, and also started his new company, GOQii, where he's on a mission to transform the healthcare sector in our country and make sure that every Indian gets fit by playing games. In this episode, we've also talked about what are the four components, what are the emotions, what are the exact chemicals which goes on in your mind every time you see a product, you see a service, or you see a game. Watch this episode till the end. You are also called a gaming king of India. And why is that? Like, what's the scene of gamification or gamifying everything?
I mean, more than gamifying everything, it's about building games. And I've been a computer gamer all my life.
And just started, like, just a trivia to for everyone, like, you sold your first gaming company at $100 million to Disney, right?
I mean, all I'm saying is that that doesn't matter. What matters is I was having fun, okay. You know. And that has been the most important part of my journey. I started by coding games on a computer called the Sinclair ZX Spectrum. Most people listening to this podcast may have not even heard of this.
No.
This is literally among the first computers which used the Z80 processor. And there was an audio cassette. The way you used to store, load a program and store using an audio cassette. I'm talking about pre-floppy disk time.
Okay, wow.
I coded my first games on it. And then, of course, I went through every generation of computing. And by 1996, 97, I was very good at making games. And that's when I started my company and I said, who's going to give me business? And that's when I realized that that I could go to brands and convince them to pay me money to make games featuring their brands.
Okay.
And this was a crazy idea. And my first customer who gave me a lot of money at that time again was a company called, of course, you all know Pepsi.
Okay.
So Pepsi's office was very close to my house.
Huh.
So what I did was I went in an auto rickshaw, took a computer and a PC, like a desktop with me, went there, and I was sitting in their reception. I said, I want to meet your marketing head. Mm-hmm. So they're like, who the hell is this kid who's here with this computer? They said, okay, you know, and this guy comes in after 1 hour.
Yeah.
He says, okay, what do you have? So I had made a game where I created Coke cans.
Okay.
And Pepsi bottle was like a cannon.
Okay.
And wo bottle se aap dabaoge button to ek wo uska cap nikalta and Coke can ko udata. And Pepsi and Coke had the biggest rivalry. They were like, wow, ye to bahut sahi cheez hai. So Pepsi guys were completely fascinated by it. Yeah. So their HR manager came and said, mere ko ye chahiye, apne sare employees ke computer pe load kar do ye. Taki jabhi bhi unko Coke se khunas ho, wo log ye kar de. And then after I did this, they introduced me to their national marketing head, a lady called Vibha Rishi. Vibha is now, you know, on boards of companies. And I know Vibha when she was the first marketing director of Pepsi.
Okay.
And when she, when she saw the game, jab dekha ye, so she was like, why don't we put this in movie theaters and let people play this and have fun?
movie theater mein, how
so
will
movie theaters mein, we created kiosks with touch screens. This is before Apple came up with a touchscreen phone. We had touchscreen computers with this game where you played the game and you hit Coke cans and then you get Pepsi as a reward. That was our first big project and they paid me almost 5 lakhs to do it. Again, you know, this was like just me turning up and showing this. In 1998, I got my second big break, and this is during the Kargil war. You know, like everybody, we were all upset, and I created this game called I Love India, where you could shoot at all the terrorists and all those people. And, you know, in short, you were like playing this game, and I put it online. That game internet was just introduced in India. 1997, my internet aata hai, 1998 ki baat hai. We had speeds of 256 kbps. And this game was maybe 1 MB file size. So, isko download karne ko aadha ghanta lagta tha. We at that time had close to 3 lakh downloads of this across the world. There was a story done on this by BBC, by Star News. That time they had Star News. And this became one of the most popular games at that time. The bottom line is that by just having the skill of making games, I was not only able to get customers, I was even able to convince investors to back this to create IndiaGames. Of course, IndiaGames' ki journey was exciting in itself. We raised several rounds of capital. In fact, I don't know if you know, but the most popular game of IndiaGames is actually, if you Google it, you'll see a number of case studies about it. We were the first company who created Spider-Man for mobile phones across the world.
Okay.
We had a license from Marvel Comics. I went to New York, got the license for worldwide rights to Spider-Man.
Wow.
And that was our biggest hit. It became so big that we almost made, if I'm not mistaken, again, ye 2004 ya 5 ki baat hai, almost $1.5 to $2 million in revenue on that one game.
The Peter Pan type.
This was the Spider-Man game. And this predates smartphones. So that time, gaming was on feature phones. And sab log bol rahe the gaming ko if mobile phone pe chalne wale nahi hai, sab idiot stupid idea hai. So the one common theme for my businesses was whenever I told my idea, people said it's a stupid idea. And I said, yaar, ye matlab theek line pe hai. You know, imagine in 2001, I told our investors ki that time mobile phones were just introduced and we said it's going to be the biggest device to play games. People are going to play for, you know, pay money to play these games. And it is going to be the biggest entertainment device. And gaming within entertainment will be the biggest segment.
Yeah.
And they all said, this is all bullshit. Koon dega? 16 rupay per minute call ka charge tha. So anyway, to cut a long story short there, IndiaGames was a fantastic learning experience for me because I was a kid. I jokingly say I got my most expensive MBA because I was a college dropout. So I learned so many things from all making mistakes, and which is what I always say, right? The smartest people are who learn from other people and figure out rather than making their own mistakes. So which is why I really appreciate your idea of doing this show, because I keep seeing people repeat the same mistake again and again, which is the most stupid thing to do. At least make new mistakes.
Yeah, that makes sense. Now, look, I want you to highlight, because your journey, as you said, that was the most expensive MBA you got, right? So tell me the three biggest mistakes or three biggest lessons you got out of it.
So I would say the three big, I would not say mistakes. I would say that three big things I would do differently and learn. So one was the team. I think there was a time I figured out that I did not have the right team. And a lot of times hiring for a startup is very, very critical. So I will talk about our hiring lessons, but I think there was a very important aspect of how to hire people and get you in the team, which was very important. The second thing was about figuring out who the right partners should be in your investors.
Okay.
A lot of times people just get investors for money, but that is not the right way to look at it. You should always look at investors who can add value more than money. And I would say that having the right set of investors can make a very big difference to a company. And thirdly, which again is very, very critical from a learning perspective, is product quality. I think people do not spend enough time on product, building their product. And today's world, kya ho gaya? Consumer is having the best. People can download and play the best game in the world. It's free. Yeah. People can use the best app, which is Uber or Facebook or Instagram or Twitter. So if you are not as good or as better than the best in the world, people are not going to take you seriously. So I think this whole aspect of I'm going to be India mein best or I'm going to be good in this does not work, because your consumer is comparing you to the best in the world. So IndiaGames was building the games which are best in the world at that time to succeed. You can't say I'm best in India or best in Bombay or best in Delhi and succeed.
This makes so much sense, because your customer is generally comparing with the best of the world. Like, they are using the world's best phone, downloading world's best apps, building their profiles and giving all their attention and time to the world's best creators and the best experiences. How do you expect them to? Unko thodi kuch fark padta hai ki tum India ke best ho ki Bombay ke best ho ki kahan ke best ho? Because you've built games, right? I'm sure it's not only your skill of building games. It's about your skill to identify consumer behavior. You understand how people think, because for any game or any product to stick around and get viral, there has to be some psychology behind it. So you tell me, what have you experienced? How do people think? How do you build product for them?
So it's a very interesting question you have asked, right? So the question you're actually asking is, how do you make something fun?
Yeah.
Because the problem is, so if you imagine an X and a Y axis of, let me use the word, experience level and difficulty. So let's say my experience level is new. I've just started playing this game.
You're here.
I'm here. And suddenly you give me something which difficulty level is 10. So what is going to happen is, I will play it once, I'll play it twice, then I'll say, bakwas hai. I will get what is called frustrated, because my experience is less and my difficulties level is more. Now let's flip it, that my experience level is 10 and difficulty level is 0. It's too easy.
Yeah.
So you'll say boring. So what we essentially do in the world of games is, we figure out that what can we do to keep managing the experience and the difficulty level to keep you in this zone of having fun. So there is a zone of fun, and fun ke upar frustration hai aur boring hai. And this applies to everything in life. So imagine you're working in a job where you're very qualified, but your company is giving you very stupid, simple things to do. Eventually you will get bored and say, yaar ye mein kya hai, office mein kuch kaam nahi hai, I'm getting bored and frustrated.
Yeah.
Right? Or you are extremely, like, your qualifications is less, but you have been given some massive job which is out of your scope. You are not delivering, you are getting frustrated, and that is causing you frustration. But when you are having fun is when you are getting challenged. So your job or your expectation should be slightly above or below your experience level. That is when you are saying, maza aa raha hai, I'm having fun.
Makes sense.
And this applies to everything in the world, whether it is education, whether it is business, whether it is gaming, whether it is friendship. You experience fun with friends when you are having the long-term relationship and you know each other's level, versus, you know, you meet somebody for the first time, you don't know whether that person likes, right? So this is broadly what gaming is. And people don't know this. People think gaming ka matlab hai leaderboard laga do, ya points de do. No, no, gaming is far beyond it. It's figuring out, how do you be in this zone? And to be in this zone, you know, human brain is nothing but a chemical factory. Okay. Your brain secretes a number of chemicals which creates emotion. So, for example, there is dopamine. There is endorphins. There is oxytocin. There is serotonin. And then there is a chemical which is not good called cortisol.
Okay.
So you can actually induce these chemicals playing games or doing activities. And that's when you get addicted to playing a game, because that that game is giving you that happiness, the happy hormone. कि यार ये गेम खेलते हैं मुझे मजा आ रहा है तो मजा आ रहा है बिकॉज ए यू आर इन द फन जोन एंड सेकेंडली इट इज रिवॉर्डिंग यू योर ब्रेन इज गेटिंग रिवॉर्डेड बाय सिक्रीशन ऑफ दिस केमिकल सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल वेन एवर यू प्लेड मारियो यू गॉट द टिंग 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 यू आर कलेक्टिंग दोज कॉइंस सो दैट गेव यू डोपामीन सो डोपामीन इज वेन यू कंप्लीट अ टास्क और अ लाइक बटन ऑन फेसबुक और इंस्टाग्राम इज अ डोपामीन हिट बट डोपामीन का प्रॉब्लम पता है क्या है वो आपको आपने फर्स्ट वीडियो आपका डाला था उसमें 1 million व्यूज आ गए बट नेक्स्ट वीडियो में 1 million आ गया अरे नहीं यार 1 million में मज़ा नहीं आ रहा है तो यू नीड मोर एंड मोर एंड मोर सो डोपामीन्स प्रॉब्लम इज दैट इट वेयर्स ऑफ वेरी इजिली यू नीड मोर एंड मोर एंड मोर ऑफ दिस एंड यू मस्ट हैव एक्सपीरियंसड योर सेल्फ राइट कि आपके पोस्ट के ऊपर पहले 1000 likes आते थे अभी 1000 likes से आपको मज़ा ही नहीं आ रहा है लाइक नहीं यार 10,000 likes होने चाहिए
True.
So that's dopamine. The second thing which gaming does really well is when you play as teams. Mm-hmm. Whenever you do an activity as a team and you win as a team, that secretes a hormone called oxytocin. Okay. So oxytocin is about camaraderie and team and everything else. And and oxytocin ka jo best cheez hai that also comes from teacher and student. So okay. if you are a coach or a teacher and your students do well and you feel proud, so that time also the teacher also gets oxytocin and you also get.
Okay.
So that's a team effort. And the third thing, which is even bigger than oxytocin, which is actually the ultimate drug, is serotonin. Serotonin is secreted when you do something good. इन यू लाइक यू नो दे से कि बिलियनियर्स जो अभी उससे पैसे बांट रहे हैं बिकॉज उनको अभी मतलब इससे मजा ही नहीं आ रहा है द सेरोटोनिन इज व्हेन यू आर डोनेटिंग व्हेन यू आर गिविंग इट बैक इनफैक्ट सेरोटोनिन इज सच अ पावरफुल केमिकल दैट यू कैन गेट सेरोटोनिन बाय सीइंग समबडी डूइंग गुड विच इज वाई व्हेन यू सी दिस हार्ट वार्मिंग वीडियोज सबको पसंद क्यों है वो हार्ट वार्मिंग वीडियो बिकॉज इट इज सेक्रेटिंग सेरोटोनिन So when you see something good happening, even on screen, you also feel good.
Yeah. Those dog rescuing videos, those videos of like, you know, going to animal shelters, being like, you know, these rescuing videos where something good is happening or someone's giving to some society.
So serotonin aisi cheez hai. And then there is one other chemical, which is endorphin, which comes with physical activity. So, you know, gaming mein there was Nintendo Wii and Xbox. Yeah. So, where they wanted you to get involved in physical activities also. So, think about gaming. So, as a game developer and a game designer, I have all these tools to engage you.
Okay.
But when the science, so this is a science. It's not, so which is the problem. People don't know this, right? They are just randomly saying, ki, haan, game bana do.
Yeah.
So, when you are crafting a game, game design is a very, very big aspect.
Mm.
But one other thing I wanted to kind of add here is actually the best use of gaming in the world of apps is something you don't even know. The two biggest users of this is Facebook, Instagram, Google, Snapchat. So they are essentially nothing but gaming companies.
Okay.
But they are using this for a very different purpose. They are using it for social. For example, the streaks which you get on Snapchat. Again, you know, just to maintain their streaks, people are
using Snapchat.
Are messaging and chatting, right? So that is a great example of using gamification to create
increase your DAUs.
Not just DAUs, right? From a consumer, it's about me and you having a long relationship. So उनका डी ए यू बढ़ रहा है बट कंज्यूमर थोड़ी इसके लिए कर रहा है कि यार मैं तुम्हारा डी ए यू बढ़ा रहा हूँ कंज्यूमर इज डूइंग इट बिकॉज दे हैव काइंड ऑफ सेड दैट दिस इज योर वे टू से हाउ क्लोज आई एम टू यू से कि दिस इज सच अ गुड फ्रेंड आई हैव अ 500 डे स्ट्रीक दैट्स हाउ यू इनफैक्ट इवन से
दिस इज माय फ्रेंड सिंस XYZ डेज our bond is so strong because we are together since 3 years 2 years because the number of streaks interesting so that's what I was coming to like everyone who's watching this how can they start using the principles of gaming in their app, in their normal apps? Like, what should be there?
So I would say the other way around, that you need to first become aware of principles of gaming being used on you. So you use so many apps, you use so many products, you use so many things. Have you ever thought that am I being gamed? So, you know, there's a very interesting, again, science experiment that the minute you, your brain is aware of something, you suddenly become more conscious of it. For example, jis din aapne decide ki mujhe white color ki Toyota Innova kharidni hai, raste mein aapko वो उस हफ्ते आपको वो सडनली ऐसा लगेगा कि यार सारी
एवरी सेकंड वाइट इनोवा ले लिए
इज वाइट इनोवा व्हाट हैपेंड इट्स नॉट लाइक द वाइट इनोवा इज वेरी इट्स बिकॉज योर ब्रेन वाज कॉन्स्टेंटली लुकिंग सबकॉन्शियसली लुकिंग फॉर इट सो नाउ इफ यू से गेमिफिकेशन और गेमिंग यू शुड सी व्हाट इज द गेमिंग टारगेटेड ऑन यू एवरी टाइम यू गेट अ नोटिफिकेशन बाय सम ऐप दे हैव सेंट यू विद एन ऑब्जेक्टिव that you are going to react to something. Or every time you are opening a particular app or, you know, whichever app you use, you should start questioning that why am I getting this offer, this notification or this product or this feature? Why is it made a particular way? So first thing is you need to discover why a particular thing is done in a particular way and why could it not be done into another way. And that's when you will start realizing the power of influencing behavior. In fact, everybody out here should not only see the TED Talk, but there is a very interesting documentary called The Social Dilemma.
Yeah, I know.
By Tristan Harris. So Tristan and I, you know, we know each other pretty well. And Tristan was an insider in this company. And he's come back and said, "Ki boss, these tools are so powerful that government should actually regulate it." Like what? Kaun regulation? Bolta hai, boss, regulate karna padega because basically these tools have the same effect like drugs. But the only difference is drugs are illegal and can't be sourced. But right now, billion and trillion dollar companies are targeting, you know, AIs which are billions of dollars on people's behavior. So the problem is that this has gone to another extent, and that's because of one and only one thing, this conflict of interest in business model. Jinka advertising business model hai, uska problem hi yahi hai ki usko padhi nahi hai ki aapka kya hoga. Usko chahiye ki boss, aapka main attention le aaun apne paas, DAU, and then make you click on some ad, taki you increase my ARPU. That's the only metric of their success, unfortunately, which is what is creating this whole problem, which is why Web3 and other models are coming, because the big, all these big giant companies have completely influenced behavior. So politicians can pay and say, "I want people to think in a particular way," and they can actually do it. They can show you kind of content if you have some kind of beliefs. Aapko waisa hi content dikhega. Aapko waisa hi friends milenge. Wohi post aapke, you know, amplify ho jayenge. So, you know, they can really create this behavior. And already, you know, US election results, there is so much debate on it, right? So, so I think people need to first be aware ki aap pe kya ho raha hai.
Can you think of any two, three examples when you felt ki, wow, I am being played, and this is one of the best ways I have been played on?
So
any,
I mean,
app, any time, no, when no, you so felt like, yeah, ye toh bahut achha kiya unhone, like, what was it? This is brilliant, out of the box thinking that somebody has played a game on me.
No, no. So I would say the number one app to do that is Netflix. Netflix, Reed Hastings, if you again Google it, he said that the biggest competition of Netflix is sleep. They don't want people to sleep. That's their competition. So Netflix has created this whole new phenomenon of binge watching.
Yeah.
Pehle television mein serial aata tha har Monday, har Friday, fir agle hafte, fir agle hafte, fir agle hafte, abhi is shrinkhla ka agla bhag aayega. So television was always appointment programming and given in pieces to you. They said no, binge. So, ek saath 15 episode aa gaye aapke, right? And jis din wo episode aate hai, koi raat ko sota nahi hai. People want to binge watch the entire show.
Yeah.
So
I am people.
And now, but see, being aware. So the question difference is, ki next time you are binge watching a show, remember, this was done by Netflix to get your sleep away. So you, if you decide ki aaj main soonga nahi aur maine ye show dekha, which means their algorithm has won. And the day you say, nahi, 11 baj gaye, time to sleep. And you go to sleep, you have won. So you need to be aware of this. So aware, I'm not saying don't watch the show, but knowing that this was targeted at me and I got a notification is because they think that I will binge watch this for the next 5 hours. That is one very interesting thing.
Hiring is the biggest problem. Like with whether you're starting as an entrepreneur, whether you're already established entrepreneur, whether you're in a corporate, either you want to get hired or you want to hire someone. Like 20, I think most of the young people who are watching this would have one of the problems, right? So what is the right process to hire? Like how do you hire, make sure
like I said, you build the right team? If you consider that you are building a team of superheroes, then who would be your hiring person? It has to be you. Right. The point is that a lot of times in startups, people are like, haan, maine ek do log ko manager ko le liya, aur wo manager abhi logo ko hire kar raha hai. So there is this very interesting formula, and I'm sure everybody has heard some versions of it. It's called A equals to A, but B equals to C. Okay. Iska kya matlab hai? Iska ye matlab hai, if I am a person, top person, good person, I will always get another good person in the system. But if I am a B person, I will never get somebody who's better than me. I always get somebody lower than me. B will always get you C. So the problem is if you are recruiting and not having the A people in your recruitment, let me use the word, who finally take a call, you will end up having an organization of C's and D's only. Because wo ek B ne aapka pura organization ko chopat kar diya. And I experienced something similar in IndiaGames. When I saw that the quality of our people was very bad, and that's when I figured out ki kya hua, HR manager ko, un logon ne bola humko log hire chahiye, HR manager ke paas target tha, managers ko log chahiye the, in log dono ne aapas mein bola yaar tumko 20 log chahiye, usne bola haan mereko chahiye, inhone jo bhi pehle 20 log mile unko pakad ke hire kar liya. So what happened was the hiring was not done because this person was the right person. It was done because the two managers wanted to meet their target and they said, yaar, jo milta hai usko hire kar lo. And this is what actually happens in a lot of places. But if you're truly building a team of superheroes, for example, in my case, all final interviews happen with me. Okay. Whether you are coming for a president's job or a job which is a much lower, let's say you are an office manager, I'll be doing the final interview. If not me, there are other members of our core team who can do this. So there is always, so what happens is that even now what has suddenly happened is that every person trying to recruit has to think, oh God, will Vishal like this person or not? Because they are no longer now considering B as their benchmark, right? Because they know that if the person is not A, the person, and that's what happened. What happened was the first 50 resumes were rejected. And now the HR guys were like, oh God, now they started filtering better people. So it all goes, the input for you is people. The second thing which I always tend to do is whenever I look at resumes, I don't look at the educational. I always look at the extra curricular. And it's so bad, unfortunately. A lot of people write all kinds of nonsense over there. Photography, yoga, kuch bhi log, you know, people write all that.
Bhale karte nahi honge.
So people who write photography, I say, can you show me your photographs? And today, toh, I said, Instagram, matlab, you should have put it. 9 out of 10 people do not even have one photograph to show. Rejected outright. Then there was somebody who had written that, oh, I can run 10 kilometers in 50 minutes. Usko dekke, so I bola, are you sure? I said 10 kilometers in 50 minutes is actually quite fast. I mean, it's not
it's not easy.
No, main to har hafte karta hun. Tula, okay, kaam karo. Take any app you want, record, you know, using the app and just send us the data. Person never came back. So what happens is that character of people is not judged in the main sections. I'm sure they have answers for it, but every time people write their extracurriculars is when you will be able to find out the true character of these people, because they tend to lie then. And then you also find people who are passionate. I have also found people jisko photography bola to usne apna pura website bata ke, you know, aisi aisi photographs click ki hain, kya kya bataya, right? So there are people, so you will find the gems not upar but
niche.
But niche, right? So it becomes, and so I'm not
That's
a here
good way to, look at it.
I'm not really looking here, you know, to evaluate whether you know coding or you don't know. I'm sure that by the time, you know, our various people have interviewed you. And finally, I think one very important question I ask people is that what question do you have for me? Because people who come to interviews who don't have a half decent question for me, it just shows that, you know, maybe they are not very serious for this, right? Because this is a job is a two-way process. It is not just ki yaar, and in, especially if you are smart, you should be having multiple options, right? I mean, if you are a complete dodo and you only have one job and you're saying, no, you are the only job. So I think a question to ask every candidate is, what question do you have for me? And that gives you a very good sense of what people are thinking.
Okay, you tell me, you have also worked in a large corporation. You were heading UTV, right?
I mean, I was with Disney, which was
okay, Disney.
Which was I was only there for a year, just to clarify. I'm not into big corporations.
Okay, so my next question was this, like, you've worked in a big corporation like Disney, which is like, which I'm sure every year, if there's a list that top organizations to work
best
with,
company to work
Disney, with. Disney comes out at the top, right? They come always in the top list. That so you worked there and you ran startups. What's the difference between corporate and startup?
So again, like I said,
you have been managing director there and you have been this founder CEO here as well. So both the companies.
So I would say that if you are somebody who enjoys being a manager, working for a large, structured, organized company, you would love a place like Disney, because Disney is designed. It's now almost 100-year-old company. Billions of dollars in revenue. So Disney has been designed for safety, for predictability, for predicted growth, for making sure that all employees in the world feel inclusive. So it is like, let me use the word, it's a place which has a lot of comforts. But as an entrepreneur, you are exactly the opposite of this, right? So as an employee and as a manager, you would love a place like Disney. But as an entrepreneur, you will find it challenging because there are so many rules. You know, that's the whole problem, right? I mean, if you were all about rules, you will be finding your time in not just Disney, but any large corporate challenging, because you can only, if you have 1 lakh plus employees, you have to have some rules. Otherwise, to kuch bhi ho raha hoga. So while Disney was a great time for me, but it was not a place for an entrepreneur, which is why I left Disney to start something else. But I think that's the big difference, right? So ye jo bade companies ka strategy to keep people kya hai, is to give them a comfort zone, to give them, matlab, to give them higher salary, this, that. So that's why they don't want people to leave, because they give you what I say, right? The drug called salary. So you are on that. And a lot of smart people even listening to this are working in comfortable jobs. But reality is ki, yeah, you are working in a comfortable job. But if you step out of your comfort zone is where you can do great things. But of course, stepping out of the comfort zone is not easy.
Yeah.
You know, being an entrepreneur, and my favorite quote is, being an entrepreneur is like being hit by lightning every day. But just live like it was just another day and keep doing your job. In fact, the day you're not hit by lightning is when you find ki aaj kya ho gaya, kuch hua nahi galat.
See, you're not disrupting enough if you're not actually getting hit by lightning. So people are watching this. They want to start their careers. And in the beginning, I always say this, that if you don't have an idea of what you want to do, you join someone who you feel like has an idea of doing something. Right. So if you feel like that, say, I want to do something in the healthcare space, and after listening to this podcast, you feel like, oh, damn, he's the right guy. Go write an email. Try to join him. Maybe you will learn 5 things which will help you come up with an idea for your entrepreneurship.
So the best way I describe is that you may not have an idea, but do you have a superpower? Work on your superpower. Now, the superpower could be following up.
Okay.
I am the best at following up. Matlab kisi ne bola follow up karo, to main follow up ka superhero. You know, or I am the superhero of sales. Or I am the superhero of content writing. Aap mere ko content do, I will write the best content and bring you. I am the superhero of SEO. Superhero means you should not be average. You should be beyond the best.
Okay. So how do you find that superpower?
So you can develop it. That's the whole point, right? Today, between all the online resources and all the YouTube hacks and everything, you can choose your superpower. Mm-hmm. And then if you go to a company and say, ki, Raj, you are a content company. I have the best. I'm the best at getting you top position on YouTube. You know, when anybody searches entrepreneurship, I know everything. That's my superpower. Will you have me work for you even as an intern? You'll say, of course. So that is the problem, is people have average or below average skills and they are expecting to work with companies which are having plans to change the world. You know, wow.
You've traveled a lot as well.
Yeah.
What have you noticed, like, the differences between employees or entrepreneurs in America and India? Because America is a superpower. You've been to New York, you've been to Silicon Valley or every place, right? So what's the difference there and here?
So I think times have changed a lot. There was a time when there was a belief that innovation can only happen in Silicon Valley. Today, innovation is happening everywhere but Silicon Valley. That is what has happened. Okay. So, pehle ye pura impression hota tha that everything is in the West. Now, everything has actually come to the East. Startup innovation is happening in China. You know, TikTok, you know, forget about the ban in India. It has taken over America.
Yeah.
It is more popular than any other social media app today. And Americans are only using TikTok. Yeah. Just a best example. Similarly, if you see so many Indian products now, which are going in, which are breaking out in all global markets, I wouldn't be surprised to see the next big TikTok-like app coming from India. So first of all, this whole concept is broken. The second thing, which is very interesting, is that, and again, you know, I was traveling recently outside India and I met a lot of few people. So there was this whole concept of BRICS. Hmm. BRICS countries mein investment ho raha hai. Brazil, Russia, India, China, and whatever, South Africa. What has happened is, for whatever reason, China has closed itself. Russia is having these issues. Brazil is having a lot of issues. And South Africa is comparatively a smaller market. So basically, BRICS mein se sirf I bacha hai. So if anybody is looking at investing, India seems to be the only destination, because you can't invest anywhere outside because of all the other challenges these regions are facing. So capital will be available in abundance in India. The only difference is that right now capital was also going after some, you know, very, very irrational ideas. And which is a problem. I think now, at least after this new, after this crash, as we say, people are going to ask, ki yaar, ye cheez ka use kya hai? How will it help humanity? I think my bigger question is, for example, I know, while I know there are startups who have raised billions of dollars to do 10-minute delivery, my question is, how is it going to change the world if you are able to deliver something to me from 10 minutes to 20 minutes? How does that change the world? I don't know. Maybe they know why it will change the world, but I don't think so. Today, we have such huge problems, right? COVID has created this huge challenge to the world. I say the next superpower will not be a company or a country with bombs or armies. It will be a country with healthy people. Because bomb or army ki kya zarurat? Padegi nahi aapko. Agar next koi virus aa gaya to. So the concept of what is going to be a superpower itself is changing. Similarly, if you look at the challenge of energy, I think we all know that climate change is going to happen and some country or some city is going to go underwater. Wo to hone wala hai. It is kab. It is like virus aane wala hai. Sab ne bola tha, picture bhi ban gayi thi, sab ne warning di thi, par sabko laga tha kabhi hoga nahi. Ho gaya. Similarly, jo climate change warnings which have been given, believe me, if not today, tomorrow it is going to happen. And then suddenly the world will say, why the hell are we using so much fossil fuel, so much pollution? I'm just saying these are all the problems which we have to fix for the future generation. So one very important thing, and you know, I'm again a big fan of thinking long term, that everything you do today, you have to see what effect will it have to not your kids, but your grandchildren. That is how you need to think of a business today.
Nice.
If you can see what are you going to leave for your future generation. When we go back and see what was left for us by our past generations, we see something. We see a different world. But in the last 50 years, world, you know, climate, pollution, all that is a big challenge. So what is going to happen in the next 50 to 100 years is what we need to think.
I have an idea of, hey, I feel this is a problem and I want to solve this problem for my grandkids. Like by the time that happens, it's truly going to make an impact in the world. I have a big vision, I have a big problem to solve. Where do I start? Because start is the most difficult part. Because I believe that once you start something, so you wear your shoes, you get on the ground and then you start running. And once that momentum is there, then it's very easy to run. Then it's very easy to finish. It's very difficult to start. It's easier to finish than to start. So I feel how to build that momentum is a question which I want to ask to you.
So I think, you know, people think start ka matlab starting a company. Start ka matlab could be writing a blog post, could be writing a Twitter thread, could be writing a LinkedIn story that I personally am passionate about this. So what happens is, wo bolte na ki you have to set out intention. Intention aapki hai, logo ko batao, bolo ki this is the problem I feel in the world, right? And what will happen is automatically you will start attracting people who will have similar thoughts or similar ideas. Network with people. I think people cannot sit at home and expect to find co-founders. Mere paas sabse zyada, I am trying to find a co-founder. Aise tum mail likh rahe ho, tumko kabhi nahi milne wala hai co-founder. So these things happen because of what I call serendipity. I love traveling and meeting people because most things happen because of random encounters.
Hmm.
Nothing can happen because it is pre-planned. So if you think everything can be happened by pre-planning, then there was no question of random encounters. Most of my deals have happened because I had gone for some other meeting and I met somebody else and then somebody else made me do something else. Right? Yeah. Or you send me a random post on Instagram, which I responded to and which ended up in this meeting. Right? So the point is, randomness is not randomness. It is an opportunity for you to level up.
Wow. Kya line hai ye? Randomness is just not any other event. It's an opportunity for you to level up.
So if you think something is random, you have to take that as an opportunity and do it.
What do you feel like, what's going to be the next big industry? I mean, you kind of answered the question with climate change and stuff, but still.
No, I think the next big industry, I have a slightly different answer for this. So we are now, you know, there's this whole question of Web3. Web3 kya hai? You know, I'm sure a lot of people are confused about it and they think ye crypto hai, ye wo hai. Actually, ye crypto nahi hai. Web3 is the next revolution in the world of internet. So the way to think about Web3 is, Web3 is what democracy did to our society before dictatorship or before the rules of monarchs and kings. That is what is Web3. So let me give you an example. Today, Facebook has a popular user base of like 2 billion. It is more than any country or almost as big as a country. We are all spending most of our time digitally. So in short, we are citizens of Facebook.
Yeah.
But we have no rights. Anything, your accounts can be shut. Every content you put on there is owned by Facebook. Facebook can decide what ads to do. Facebook has all the policies. The person who's owning Facebook, Zuckerberg, and his shareholders are getting rich. Mm. They are the zamindars of this digital Facebook land. And we are who? We are data creators. Hum unko data de rahe hain. Data ke badle unko aapko muft mein Facebook use karne ko liye diya hai na aapko. you are getting it free. But using your data and your behavior, they have made billions and billions and billions of dollars, trillions of dollars. So Web 2 mein kya hua ki there are 5-6 these large companies who use you because they say maine aapko product free de diya, like the old king ki aap to hamare yahan free mein reh rahe ho, matlab par aap se lagan le rahe hain wo log, right? By using data. Data is the currency. That data is used to enrich their algorithms, to enrich their targeting mechanisms, to enrich everything else. In Web3, what the fundamental is, they are saying that if we are all going to use a social network, these 1 billion people could use my social network, which we will all create using a DAO. We can all vote for it. And then every time you give me data, I am going to give you a token, which is our coin. And the more you contribute to this network, you will start getting these coins, which will make you rich. And then you can use this coin for paying for services, and you create your own micro economy of this. Now, just think about Instagram. Today, as a creator or YouTube, you're creating content. You don't even know what percentage of money you are getting.
Yeah.
It's a black box. It's a black box. We have no idea. But a future platform, Web3 YouTube platform, will be fully transparent. You will know, you know, you will get your payout and you become the owner of the platform. Yeah. That is the biggest difference. So today, YouTube may, if you look at the top 100 creators or top 1,000 creators, they possibly contribute to bulk of the traffic of YouTube, yeah. But they have zero ownership of YouTube. Web3 may kya, what they are effectively saying is that the users of the product will also be getting ownership of the product. So okay. If you use something, so it is like the country, same thing, right? If I live in a country, in a democracy, and the country is becoming richer, then I as a citizen, our GDP is increasing, I am getting the services. So Web3 is about democratization of the internet. So it's a much larger concept, which is why metaverse, when they are saying open metaverse, वो क्या बोल रहे हैं आपको कि currently आपका एक character Facebook में है, आपका account है, और आपका एक अलग account Google में है. These are not compatible at all. They're different world and different world. You don't have any ownership, no rights, nothing. सब कुछ belongs to them as per the privacy policy and terms and conditions. In an open metaverse, just like in the real world, आपका एक passport है जिसमें आपको citizenship दे दी गई है. तो आप India से travel कर सकते हो कोई भी country में. And you are yourself, yeah. And you take your possessions, you can take your money, your credit card and use it there. So all the assets I own, you can technically ship it to anywhere in the world, wherever you can travel. Similarly, what they are talking about in open metaverse concept is in the future, there will be a social network or a learning app or a video app where your same credentials will be used. If you had bought a pack here, you could use the pack there. You could be truly interoperating between different apps and services. And they're calling this metaverse because think of this as a world in itself and you are a citizen of that world. So people are trying to say, kya rahi, ye crypto hai, ye wo hai, because people have not understood the broader idea of Web3 and metaverse.
You remind me of a person, like a very good friend, Anshul. He runs a company called Zionverse, if I've heard of it. So Zionverse is essentially, they are building their metaverse where what they are saying is, you come play with us and every time you play, we're going to give you token.
So play to earn. That's a very big
P to E, right? And what they've done is they have kind of made it really fun by calling it Sanskari. So it's like, if you're being Sanskari on the app, what they mean by Sanskari is if you follow the protocols, if you invest your time, if you are on time every time, you help other people as well in there. So every time you are being generous, you are being Sanskari, you get rewarded.
So that's the whole idea, right?
That's the rewarding.
Idea is that they are telling you that by using my app, you will also become wealthy.
Yeah.
Jabke, if you use any of the other apps, you are only losing your time. So that is the fundamental difference in the Web3 versus Web2. And that is going to have a big change in the world.
Thank you so much for doing this. Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot. It was a pleasure. And I think we didn't realize it. Time just flew off.
Thank you for watching this till the end. Please subscribe this channel and share it with as many people as you can, because you never know who will get out the best out of this conversation, and maybe you or maybe your friend or your family member can get their $1 billion opportunity or an idea from just one conversation. So maybe this is that conversation for them. Thank you so much for watching.